Hi everybody.
Hi.
Nice to see you. We want to speak today about this parasha. I don't want to make it too heavy because I understand we are coming after a whole day of work and there. I don't want them to come and slowly fall asleep in front of my eyes. So I'll try to make it interesting so it won't be too heavy. This parasha, Parashat Vayera, we start, Hashem is sending Moshe, his messengers, to save the Jewish nation. So they are there for a long time already, and Moshe and Paro is taking advantage of the Jewish people. He abuses them. He does whatever he wants with them. You know, they work for free in his land for so many years. He kills their babies. He does with them whatever he wants. And it's time to get out of Egypt. So he sends Moshe. And because Paro is so arrogant person, because he is so proud of himself, Hashem punishes him first. 50 times it says that people, with the Jewish people, were left Egypt. 50 times in the Torah, more than 50 times. And there's a mitzvah aseh to remember the fact that we left Egypt. It wasn't easy. If Hashem wouldn't make these miracles, we would stay till today over there, we would mingle there, and that would be the end of the Jewish people. So we keep reminding in all kind of mitzvah that we do during the day, that Hashem saved us from there, and we became free people. We're not slave to anybody anymore. We're free to worship Hashem. Mm. So Yitzhak Mitzrayim really teaches us emunah, faith in Hashem. One time, there was this big rabbi by the name Rav Israel Salanter. And Rav Israel Salanter came once to a hotel and met over there the manager. The manager was once a religious Jew, but he decided that he's not religious anymore. Stop wearing kippah, stop keeping Shabbat, stop eating kosher, stop fulfilling mitzvot. And Rabbi Yisrael Salanter is asking him, can you explain it, please? I remember you were just Jew, you were observing. What exactly happened that you stopped keeping all those mitzvot? He tells him, I'll tell you the truth. I met once with another non-believer. He was in this hotel, and he tells me, you know something? I'll show you, I'll prove you that Hashem doesn't punish us if I do something wrong. He takes out from his pocket a non-kosher salami and he eats that.
Salami.
Something happened to you? You see that Hashem punished me? You see that Hashem choked me or did something? Nothing. And I keep eating this salami all the time and Hashem doesn't punish us. So you could go ahead and do whatever you want. He was obviously very weak in his emunah, in his faith in Hashem. So he believed in him and slowly stopped keeping the mitzvot. So Rabbi Yisrael Salanter is supposed to answer him something now. So he waits at the right moment, at the right time. And then his daughter comes from school. And she's so happy. The daughter got a diploma that she knows how to sing very beautiful. She got a diploma from school and she shows it proudly to her father. Daddy, look at this. They gave me this diploma. Now I can go ahead and sing in concerts. They will invite me here. They will invite me there. So the father is very happy. But the rabbi is asking, can you sing in front of me? I want to see how exactly you sing. She got very offended. She says, I have this diploma. That's a proof that I know how to sing. I cannot go, I don't have to go and prove myself constantly to everybody that wants to hear my voice. I don't have to prove him that I know how to sing. This diploma shows. That was what Yisrael Salanter was trying to tell the person. This person. He told him, Hashem showed us already so many miracles once we came out of Egypt. And when we got the Torah and when we were in the desert, and all the Bible is full of miracles that Hashem did to us. But to every person that comes and tells Hashem, demands, Hashem, show me a miracle, if not, I'm not going to be a Jew. Hashem must change the whole nature of the world because of him. It doesn't make sense. So that's what we learn from Yitziat Mitzrayim. Faith. And as I said, I don't want to make it too heavy, so let's go and start ahead. We see how in the 10 plagues that Hashem gave on the Egyptians, how there is the divine providence in this world, how Hashem takes care of little details, big details, everything all together. Imagine to yourself, and I'll try to do it, we're not talking about something that happened 3,000 or 4,000 years ago. Try to think that this, God forbid, things happening today, how would we react? What would we do if such a thing would happen? Imagine to yourself Egypt, or not Egypt, any, let's say America, the greatest nation in the world, is wealthy, has properties, have things to offer to the people. Obviously, then with culture, with things, obviously people, you know, naturally, well, the nation, people who live here, they become kind of arrogant. You know, there's all kind of countries in Africa, countries in that they are very, not, they're not modern. And we can offer them a lot. And so, and let's say there are a lot of slaves, you know, a lot of foreigners that live in this country. And so they, the way that they act to them, the way that they think about it, about America 200 years ago, let's say, how they act, how they were, how they were with a slave, that with the black people that were living here, they were slaves. It wasn't a nice, it wasn't a nice situation over here. So Hashem sends Moshe to redeem the Jewish people with all kind of punishments. To the king, to the president, to whoever rules over here. We start with blood, the first plague. The Nile was the most important thing in Egypt. In Egypt, you know, where Egypt is in Africa. There's not so much rain over there. It's close to the desert. Obviously, people need the water over there because it's a hot weather usually, and you need water. But the Egyptians had one big blessing, the Nile. From time to time, it would come and water the whole land. So they didn't depend on rain like most countries. If we don't have rain here for 1 month, for 2 months, for 3 months, in Israel, let's say people don't have rain in the winter, this drought, it's very hard, there's nothing to drink, the cattle's died, the trees and the fruits and the vegetables, everything gets dry, it's so hard. All of a sudden over there, in a place that always had water, not for drinking, not for washing, not for taking a shower, not to anything. How hard it is when somebody cannot drink. People can die from thirst, God forbid, you cannot drink blood. So, there's no water. What, how much you're going to search for it, there's no water. It's so, so hard. The self-confidence of the Egyptians was its Nile. And Hashem shows them that their God, the Nile, is nothing. Hashem rules over the Nile. Hashem decides when is going to be water, when is going to be famine, when is going to be drought, when you're going to have health, when you're going to have wealth, when you're going to have everything, anything you want in this world. So, think about this. Some people, they enslave themselves to all kind of gods. What does that mean, gods? We don't believe in gods today, right? But people believe in, let's say, I want to succeed in life. So I do anything to succeed. This is my boss. This is my boss. And when I decided that I have to succeed, I'll do anything I can to get succeed.
So in work you must be perfect. You have to come, you have to work, you have to spend hours. You give all yourself. And at home you have to be successful. And you have to look nice. And you have to, you know, you have to make a, you have to go to the fitness center to look nice. And your appearance and your relationship with your husband, with your children, with your in-laws, with the house, the money. Money is success. You work so hard for this success that you forget on the way a little bit about spiritualism, about what's important in life, you know? When you're so constantly busy, because it takes, you can't, you people can be busy, but when they're too busy to be successful, they forget sometimes the more important thing in life, like family relationship, communicating with God, okay, doing mitzvot and stuff like that. So sometimes this God dictates them, this boss dictates them what to do, when to do, how to do, and people have to be careful, because when they devote themselves to this, to these things, to money, to whatever they run for, and they're not happy, they're tired, they're exhausted, they don't know what to do with themselves, and they don't have any time to spirituality. Sometimes people have bad qualities, and these are their bosses. Like, for him, you know, he's an arrogant person. You cannot talk to him. He is an angry person. He looks for honors, for kavod. And for these things, he'll do anything, and you cannot stop him. And if he has bad qualities, and he doesn't work on himself, and this is what leads him in his life, he's poor. If he cannot change his qualities, he's very poor. Some people run after movies, internet. How much time do you spend on the internet? It's unbelievable sometimes how much time people spend on this. If you would spend this time on some other things, you know how much chesed you would be able to do with people, with family, with community, with yourself? You're searching, you're reading, you're learning, you're doing things. But when you're busy with the internet, it takes all your time, and takes all your schedule, takes all your devotion, and you have no time to anything afterwards. This is what happens when people runs after their own gods. Money is a very, very strong issue where we speak about God. It is written on the coins or on the American dollar, "In God we trust." But the idea is, this is our God. I want to tell you an example from our own Bukharian tradition. There was a man in Russia, in Bukhar, in I think he was living in Tashkent, Samarkand, I guess. His name was Avraham Kalantarov.
Yeah.
Kalantarov.
Yes. Samarkand.
He was a very rich man. About 20 something years ago, we went to visit Russia. We went to visit the communities that still lived in Russia, and people took us to the house that he was living. The whole block was his house. Not only one home, one house. The whole block was his house. And when you enter there, you see the beauty, you see the richness, you see the wealth that he was living till today. Today, the Russians made it a museum. And it's so beautiful, the details, the golds, the articles that he had over there. Beautiful, beautiful, beautiful. This man, not only the house was rich, he had a lot of bonds, he had a lot of money, he had shares here, he had shares there, he had whatever he wanted. One day, the rabbi of Samarkand at that time, Rabbi Yaakov Kaiko, Zecher Tzadik Livracha, he was talking about how Hashem in one moment can make rich people fall, you know, and make poor people go up. this Avankala was listening to his lecture, and he says, "Rabbi, you're talking nonsense today." So the rabbi, what do you? And he says, "How can a person lose his money in 1 second? You know how much money I have?" He tells him, "You cannot even count. Even God forbid, if I lose something here, I still have there. If I lose something, my home, I have my business. If I, how can you say that in 1 second people can lose everything?" I told him, "Be careful. You know, you're not. You can, don't open your mouth. You don't know what's going to happen." And sure, that's what happened. Sometime later, the Bolsheviks, the communist revolution started in Russia, and they come to his home. And they tell him, "You must sign that all your belongings, everything goes to the government." He didn't want. He didn't have a choice. If not, they will kill him. He himself signed with his own hands that all his money, till the last penny, goes to the government. This was his God, right? Tzvadea, frogs, is the second plague. Frogs, try to listen, try to hear the noise that all these frogs did over there. It's terrible. And they got everywhere. When somebody is very proud, when he's very, very arrogant, he feels that he's superior and he's above everybody. Hashem tries to punish him. How? Comes this little frog that usually slips away from people, tries to hide from people. Do you see frogs usually? Mm-hmm. You don't see them. Usually they hide in swamps, under this, under that. You don't really see them. And this frog gets against its nature, leaving that swamp, and comes with a chutzpah, I should say, to the most private places of the Egyptians, where it didn't go into their beds, into their linens, into their kitchens, into their, everywhere you want, they were there. The frogs try to think, try to remember, try to. The noise. They are harassing. They abusing. They humiliating. You know, these proud people. A lady is telling this story. Let's say her name is Sarah. Sarah is telling a story about her family. She said, "I had a beautiful family, kids, husband, wealth, everything was perfect. And she thought it was going to continue to be that perfect all her life." So she says that her first daughter, when she was supposed to get married, they married them with a nice family. Everything was okay. The party, the wedding, everything was beautiful. They had to pay, the other side had to pay, but that's fine, that's what we're doing as parents. Then the second daughter got married to another fine boy, and they also built their family, everything was okay, the in-laws are fine. And then the third daughter's turn came. Here, it was a bit tough because after two weddings, you know, it's not so hard, it's not so easy financially. And meanwhile, the first daughter gave birth, and then the second daughter gave birth. And, you know, they have to, the parents are helping as much as they can. You know, whether it's making the brit milah, the young couple don't have money for this yet. In Israel, it's a bit different. Here, you know, you make a party, people give you some checks, and it covers. Mm-hmm. In Israel, people don't give big checks. People, sometimes they give gift or something. And you cannot really cover the expenses of the party. So the parents are helping and they're buying these things for the baby and that thing for the baby. And then comes the third daughter's wedding, and they make conditions with the in-laws that they will pay some money and they will pay some money. They gave their share, and the other side didn't give their share. So they're waiting and waiting, and then time comes and the wedding is there and they didn't pay their share yet. And then Sheva Brachot passes and another year passes and they don't give anything. So then her daughter gets pregnant and she gives birth and they don't give anything. This is when Sarah got upset at them because here comes another, now her son's turn comes. And they don't have money to buy him nothing, not an apartment, not half an apartment, not in far away place even, not close to them, nothing. Because basically they paid most of it and the other side didn't pay anything and it was hard for them. So they had to make the breed and they had to pay the breed. And this, you know, piles up. Plus, now started to have some kind of problems. The first daughter doesn't get along with her husband for some reasons. The second daughter gave birth to twins, but they were premature. They had to stay in the hospital, and so the older is coming to them. And there's so many things that they have to go through now. It's a lot of pressure now. Then comes the pidyon of the third daughter, whatever. Pidyon means after a month, that after the first baby born is born, they make a party, they give some money to the client. This is when she burst out on her in-laws. Why they didn't pay their debts, why they didn't pay their shares. She started talking to them harshly in front of everybody, saying all kind of things, raising her voice, calling their names. She even didn't understand herself. What happened to her? She's not this type of a person. She acted not nice. She came home and she's like, what did I do to myself? She's ashamed. She ruined the whole party for the young couple. And she cannot now see her in-laws. What did she do? So yes, she called right away and she asked for apology. But what kind of apology is that? You know, she insulted them in front of so many people. And now she asked for apology, you know? It's like, okay, she said something, but it wasn't 100% asking apology and 100% forgiving. This was the end of the relationship. They were not in touch with this in-laws anymore because they insulted, she insulted them. Then the problems became severe. Her daughter, the first daughter that started to have some problems with her husband, didn't get along. So they ask for this rabbi and they go to this rabbi for help and they try this and they try that. Didn't get along. God forbid, divorced. Where does she go to live? With her parents, with her children, everybody in her house now. Her husband remarried right away. He didn't want to, new wife didn't want to hear about the children, so she takes care of them in her mother's home. Everybody's by her. The twins that were premature, still, nothing is happening over there. It's a whole big thing, and they have to go to the hospital, they have to come back. The mother, the girl, the daughter. It's a whole big problem over there. There's a lot of stress with the third girl because she doesn't speak with the in-laws, and whatever. She's stuck with the children's shidduchim because she doesn't have money, and nothing comes along, and she cannot buy, you know, in Israel it's like that, when you cannot pay, so there's no shidduch, you know? A whole big problem. But then, she got another hit. Her husband, Olenu, got a stroke. Oh. Spending time in the hospital, going there, trying this, you know, half of his body became paralyzed, and he cannot move, he cannot this, they need a physiotherapist, they need this, they need that. She goes to the hospital, she comes back, she has a daughter, she has the grandkids at home, she has this, she doesn't know what to do with herself. Okay, so slowly it gets better. He comes home after a few months being in a hospital and recovery, and again he gets another stroke. Again going to the hospital, again going to this, and again. She sits one day and she's like, what's happening to me? Why all this thing happened? She was thinking and thought, maybe it's because she humiliated publicly her in-laws. So she goes from the hospital straight to their home. She doesn't even make a phone call. She just knocks on the door, gets into the house and starts crying. She cries and she cries and she cries. And she tells her, listen, I'm so sorry. I get one hit after the other, one hit after. Please, can you forgive me 100% with all your heart? Because I just keep falling and falling and falling constantly. And she understood it, and she sees what she goes through. She was a kind lady. She told her, sure, I forgive you. Don't worry. Everything's okay. Miracles did happen right away afterwards. Her husband didn't recover quickly, chick-chack, and
but
slowly, slowly, she sees the difference. Of course, with a lot of prayers, with a lot of devotion to the family, with a lot of crying, with all of this. But slowly, slowly, Baruch Hashem, her husband gets better, and the twins are out of the hospital, and she was able to engage her next son, and then this starts moving. That slowly, slowly. Sometimes Hashem has to hit arrogant people, because otherwise they don't wake up. And this is what Hashem was trying to do to the Egyptians. Next, kinim. Kinim.
But it's not her fault.
What?
They didn't share, like you say.
What was not her fault?
They didn't pay.
Yeah, you know.
Yeah,
what I mean?
It's true. In the beginning, in the beginning, she told her that they had intentions to pay, but they couldn't and they can't from all kinds of reasons. Once she came to her home, she revealed to her that they really wanted to pay, but then something got stuck financially in the bank and they couldn't do it and whatever. It's not that they denied whatever they had to do. They didn't deny it, but they just couldn't. She didn't check the understanding. She just had all kind of pressure piled inside her, and she burst it out in front of everybody. That is not acceptable. She was not supposed to. If anything, she was supposed to sit with them privately and talk to them. And
that makes sense.
Right?
Yeah.
But instead, she humiliated her publicly, and that wasn't nice. So, lies shows that Hashem controls not only on the water and on creatures, things that come from the water, but also in the land. Because we know that the sand became lice. This plague testifies the presence of Hashem, because it made the Chachamim, the magicians themselves to say Etzva Elokim, you know, it's God, it's not, we cannot do anything. They couldn't create some creatures
small.
That are so small, right? So they said Hashem is the God. It reminds me a story that I read once when I was young. This story happened in Syria. There was this man by the name Senor de Fijuto. He was a very special man, he was a nice man, he was a respected man in Syria. One Arab guy comes to him and he asks from him a favor. Can he lend him some money? Now this Senor de Fijuto sees him and is kind of afraid, because he knows, this Arab is known that he never pays back his debts, his loans. He doesn't pay back. He cannot tell him no, because he's not a nice man, you know. So he tries to deny, but he can't. And he tells him, do you have a guarantor that will come and, you know, sign? So that if you cannot pay, he will come and pay for you? He says, no, I don't need guarantors. I guarantee that God is my guarantor. So the senor didn't have so much choice, and he says, okay, if you say God is your guarantor, I accept it. Even though he knew that he won't be able to pay, he says, okay, I'll make a kiddush Hashem, and whatever happens, happens. So he gives him the money, and this Arab took his, you know, years ago, they used to have this
pouches.
He had a red pouch. He puts it in this red pouch, 200 coins of gold. He took a lot of money for 6 months. And he puts it inside, and he goes. In his mind, this Arab was not planning to return it, because he's not this type of person that returns loans. He goes to his estate. He was rich because, you know, he made a lot of money, he made a lot of business. He goes to one of his gardens where he used to grow all kind of plants, all kind of vegetables there. And he sat next to a section where a lot of cabbages were grown over there. So he comes, and this pouch was too heavy for him. So he puts it next to him. There was this cabbage over there. He puts it on the cabbage, and he sits, he rests, he fell asleep for half an hour. He gets up, and it became dark already. So he forgot about this pouch, and he went home. He comes home, and then he remembers that he forgot his pouch with the money. He says, tomorrow morning, now I won't see anything anyway, tomorrow morning. He goes tomorrow morning, the next morning, to that garden, next to the cabbages, looks for the cabbage, doesn't find it.
So many cabbages.
The interesting thing is that at nighttime, cabbages get open, daytime they close. So now, he doesn't know where is his pouch. He's looking and looking and looking. He says, probably somebody already stole it, and who knows where it is. And he went home. He said, okay, I didn't have luck with this money. Right after this man leaves the garden, his workers are coming, and they start collecting all, you know, these crops to sell it on the market. So they take the cabbages, they take the other vegetables that he has. But usually before they go to the market, they go to this man that buys from them some of the best vegetables, and he pays good money. So they go to him, and he sees this cabbage that looks so big and heavy. He says to himself, this Senor de Pijota will buy. I know, he buys usually the best thing. He asked for me for a while already to find him a good cabbage. I'll go and then I'll take it to him. And he sells it to him, and as he opens this cabbage, what does he see? He sees this pouch. Fine, he says, Baruch Hashem, Ma Baruch HaMachzir Avada LeBa'aleha, meaning, blessed be Hashem that brings back whatever I lost, because he knew that he won't see this money back from this Arab. Later on, about 6 months later, this Arab comes to him and he tells him, you know something? I didn't have any luck with this money. It lost, I didn't even see. Can you give me a few more months until I gather the money and I'll return it back to you? So this Jewish senior, he goes to his safe, takes out a pouch, and says, is that yours? He says, yes. Where did you get it from? He tells him, tell me the truth. At the moment that you took this loan, did you have any intention in your mind to bring it back to me? He says, the truth? No. So he tells him, Hashem is the guarantor. Hashem made sure that I get it back. He says, Baruch Hashem, you and the Jewish people, Hashem of yours is very, very special, right? This is what the Kinim teaches us. Next thing is Arov. Arov means wild beast. Let's say a tiger runs away from a zoo. What happens? One tiger from a zoo.
Will run.
People run away. People are afraid. People are stuck at home. They're afraid to leave. Right? Because who knows where is this tiger? Makat Arov showed that the man is not safe even in his own home. You know why? Because Hashem, the Hashem sent them this type of an animal that's called silonit. And this silonit comes from the sea and has very, very long arms. It comes through the ceiling, breaks the ceiling, comes through the ceiling and opens with its long arms the doors to let this beast come inside the house. People are not safe anywhere. Wild beasts, not only tigers, whatever you want, God forbid. And all the streets of Egypt were filled up with these dangerous animals. And they come, and everywhere they go, They tear people to pieces. They kill people. They eat them up. And still, whatever we said till now, the Jewish people were not affected from all this. The Egyptians see, and it bothers them. Down, Jewish people didn't have. In fact, you know, the Jewish people got very rich because the Egyptians had to buy the blood, the water from them.
Yeah.
Jewish people didn't have any problems. Didn't have all these noises and this harassment that Jewish people didn't have any lies. Jewish people didn't have any wild beasts next to them. Nothing. So this discrimination bothers them so much. When he was young, he learned to be a silversmith. And when needed, he was working by this non-Jewish silversmith, and he did some jobs for him. It was very interesting though. He worked whatever he needed. If he needs $50, he works for this $50. The next 2-3 days he doesn't come to work because he doesn't need money. He counts whatever he needs money. And this kills, this bothers so much his owner, the person that he works by, because he wants to see, you know, he wants him to come more often, but you cannot, you can just talk to the walls. He's just not coming. He comes, he does whatever he needs, and he goes. One day, the king, he orders a lot of merchandise because his daughter is supposed to get married. And so, all kind of sets, all kind of jewelry, they want to present it in the engagement party. And he orders from him a lot of stuff. This work needs to be done. And as much as he tried, they didn't have a chance to finish the work because of Avichai Ben Atal was not showing up. So the king is very upset.